Lately, it's been kind of hard to wake up to an alarm clock. And for those of you that are younger, this is called an alarm clock. Because many of you are like, this is an alarm clock. Well, that is too. In fact, that's what they used to have before we had one in our pockets that you could set and snooze and all these things. You could only set an alarm one time a day. Or you had to change it for another later time if you wanted to wake up multiple times in a day. Now you can set 30 alarms on your phone, and it's an amazing world we live in. But it's difficult to wake up sometimes, depending on what your day's been like, what your week's been like. It's like, I don't know if I can get out of bed, and the Lord gives us strength. But this week's been a little bit hard for me to wake up to my alarm. I'm glad you guys woke up and were here for church. If any of you are home because you were late, know that I have compassion for you, but we miss you as well. I want to load up, though, a text I received yesterday morning, because yesterday's alarm clock was a little bit different. Yesterday's alarm clock was unique. In fact, let me pause and say this. On Saturday mornings, as men, we have a Bible study, 6:30 in the morning till 8 o'clock. And so I wanted to promote that a little bit. That's why we were getting up on Saturday morning. And if that's you, if you're a man who wants to study God's Word and you happen to be awake or willing to wake up that early, I'm not talking to you, Josh Jablonski, but everybody else, he said he doesn't wake up before like 10 o'clock, I think. And so he said if we have a later Bible study, he'll come, but maybe he'll start one later in the day for those of you that are also not morning people. But this is our plan yesterday. A man makes his plans, and what? The Lord directs our steps. Because that's not exactly the alarm that I woke up to. In fact, the alarm I woke up to at 6:13 was a text from Ed Pulowski. Help, all hands on deck, toddler and nursery rooms are flooded. Sorry. It's been a long week. Bring wet vacs if you have any, and fans perhaps, and they already did it for me, but we found 2 inches of water in the toddler room, and if you see on the right side, just water spraying out of the pipe from our well, and the well's like, hey, we're using water, keep pumping it, and so you can just imagine the mess that we walked into yesterday. But I show you this picture because on the left, we actually had repair done on Tuesday, and a little drip was fixed, was repaired. But little did we know that that repair, there was a part that was broken. You see on the right there, this little crack. But I share this with you not to build sympathy, maybe to explain a little bit why everything's in the hallway. But I share this because this really does relate well to our sermon this morning. Because we couldn't just come into the church and see this water and just, oh well, leave or have Bible study. It was kind of emergency. We got to do something. But if we spent all day vacuuming up the water, but never found the source of the problem, we'd be vacuuming to this day. Because the source matters. And if we never would have found this broken piece or turned off the water, because that was helpful as well, then this morning you wouldn't be able to use the restrooms because the water would still be off. Well, sadly, for many of us, if we're honest, we live in a world where we are flooded with information. In fact, as I'm going to reference this morning, we are flooded with what the world considers wisdom. And we are right to be asking the question, what is the source? Where is this coming from? Because if you don't find that, one, it might be a problem, but two, you might be easily tricked or easily fooled. And so this morning in James chapter 3, we're going to look at a passage at the end of this chapter that's titled Wisdom from Above, which we understand, but just knowing as Christians and from that title, it is wisdom from the Lord. But James offers that there is another option. Not all wisdom comes from above. We're wrong to think that only God has wisdom, because the world tends to offer what people might consider to be wisdom. And so we're going to see that distinction even this morning. If you have your Bibles and you're willing to stand, please stand for the reading of God's Word. If not, you can have a posture of reverence in your seat. But as you're able, please stand. This is the reading of God's Word. The Holy Spirit moves James to write, "Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Father God, we come, we bow, because you are on the throne, creator of all that we know, savior of those who put their faith in you, our king, our friend, our father. God, remind us that we are not alone. Remind us that we are dearly loved. But God, I pray that you would help us this morning through the teaching of your word and the move of your Holy Spirit to realize that we need to be awake, that we need to be alert. Because there's many things the world offers that could be a deception to those of us who just kind of go through the motions of living but hardly alive. God, I pray that we would be people of faith, that we'd be doers of the word, not just hearers of the word. But God, I pray that your word would instruct us to leave this place different because your spirit moves in us to see things as you see them. Help us. Because it's so easy to be distracted and busy with the things of the world and lose sight of you. And so I pray that we would all lay our burdens down at your feet and allow you to teach us. Because we have so much to learn. We need your help. So thanks for being willing to help. And thanks for hearing our prayers. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Well, this morning, I don't have to create a question for the text because the question is in the text. So, who is wise and understanding among you? You see that in verse 13 of James chapter 3. Now, James has this opportunity to really distinguish what is wisdom, as we're going to see. And I'm going to present to you really a three-point message twice. Don't be confused. Because there's really a parallel of these two things, of wisdom that is not from above and wisdom that is from above. And there's a really beautiful parallel as James writes this that I'm going to try to point out to you. But it starts with this question: who is wise? Who is understanding? This is a question we ask amongst ourselves. What's the recent thing we should be looking at? Have you heard of this? Have you read this book? Have you heard this speaker? And we're in pursuit of people that have something for us to learn. And so the verse goes on. James really makes the request of wisdom. And I want you to see this. It's what do we do with wisdom? And so in the verse 13, he continues on and he says, by your good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. Church, my first point to you is that wisdom is not something that you have. It's something that you use. It's not I have wisdom. It's that I'm using wisdom in the actions of my life. Remember in this text, he says, show your good works. Show your works. How? In the meekness of wisdom. If somebody has wisdom and they keep it to themselves, we would actually probably call that knowledge. Because wisdom is always used. Wisdom is always applied. Wisdom is something that I observe a truth and it changes how I act because of it. It's a posture in response to the learning. That's what wisdom is. So first thing, again, you'll notice is that wisdom is not something that you have. It's something that you use. Referencing other texts of Scripture, aiming to what James is referencing as well. In Proverbs chapter 2, verse 6, "For the Lord gives wisdom. From His mouth come knowledge and understanding." Church, you need to know the Lord does provide wisdom. But as we learn, faith without works is what? Dead. We need to apply it to our lives, not just study it in some Bible study. Well, in the book of Job, God and Job are talking, and even his friends, right? But we get this text from Job chapter 12. "With God are wisdom and might. He has counsel and understanding." And so people are aware that God is a source of wisdom. But James offers that there are other options that many people fall into, not realizing that it's not from above. Well, in Job later in 28, it says, "From where then does wisdom come? And where is the place of understanding?" If I'm honest, this is the question that many people, not knowing the Scriptures, not helped by the Holy Spirit or the Word that God has given to us, would land at the question. Where is it? And many people are just lost in the search, trying this and trying that. But notice it continues to declare to us in Job that it is hidden from the eyes of the living and concealed from the birds of the air. Abaddon and death say, "We have heard a rumor of it with our ears." God understands the way to it, and He knows its place. And then at the end of this chapter, in verse 28, God says to man, "Behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And to turn away from evil is understanding." So who is wise and understanding among us, church? We know those of us that fear the Lord. We know those of us that turn away from evil. That's what the other Scriptures would say. But notice how James applies that even in this letter. So it's not just James. James is applying a biblical truth. It's true all over the place. But church, let me encourage you to know that there is a fork in the road. There are two options. Is the wisdom from above, or is the wisdom not from above? And we are foolish to say that there's not wisdom of the world, because people would declare it that way. I'm going to use quotations on that kind of wisdom, because it's not true wisdom, but it disguises itself as wisdom. People live in response to it as if it is wisdom. So we have to understand that there is a fork in the road. Either it is or is not from above. So I'm going to adjust my sermon slide for you here and say we're going to first talk about wisdom that's not from above. And I'm going to turn a question to you, because remember we do that here at Hillside. I turn the pulpit around and let you be a part of it. And so what sources of wisdom do we find that are not from above? And you can reference individual people or organizations or networks. It doesn't matter to me. But where do we see the world offering wisdom? Planned Parenthood, they're offering to girls that are curious, "What should I do?" And they give them some answers, right? So that's an option of the world, yeah. What else? Astrology, yeah. Look to the stars. What's your zodiac? And horoscopes and all these types of things. People might reference that for their counsel, for their, what kind of year am I going to have? Yeah, what else? Evolution. Yeah, we don't know the answers, but it seems like maybe these pieces would work, and so scientific method would imply that maybe there was a start and things advanced over time. And so evolution could be the answer for people for a question we don't really know in terms of, I mean, we know the Scriptures reveal it, but a lot of us weren't there when the world was created. And so what does the world offer? An answer through evolution. Good. What else? Health remedies, diets, medication, meditation. There's a lot of things people might say is just take care of your health. You'll have a better life, have a better existence. Yeah, health remedies. What else? Teaching. Not all teaching is Bible-based. Yep, so any teaching that's contrary to the Bible, we would consider wisdom of the world. I mean, it's being taught. People must be willing to listen in some capacity. But the fact that it's not based on the Bible would make that wisdom of the world. Somebody else had something. Google and celebrities. Or, and if you're at home, I'm sorry if this messes you up, but Alexa or Siri. Some of your phones are going to go crazy. What's the weather today? What's the cheapest gas around me? Did the Cubs win last night? I mean, there's all these things that we just ask our devices to give us the answers to. You know, most kids today, if I gave them an encyclopedia, wouldn't know what to do with it. Maybe a dictionary, they might not know what to do with it. A calculator, they might not know what to do with it because the technology starts to replace it. Smartphones, if I may be honest, dumb people. I say this honestly, I had more numbers memorized at the age of 8 than I do at the age of 38. And this is a great device and it can be used for great things. But does it provide me the wisdom? Sometimes I can ask it questions. You can actually ask AI or Alexa or your phone, what is the gospel? And it'll do its best to try to tell you based on the answers that it finds on the internet or something. But in general, the internet would be a great worldly offer of wisdom. Just Google it, or aging myself, ask Jeeves. Remember that back in the day? Well, these are our sources of wisdom. Again, we are wrong to say that there is none, because the world is so easily fooled. These are wolves in sheep's clothing, as it might be, or things that are close but not really it. In fact, the worst lies in the world are the obvious ones. The most dangerous lies in the world are 99% true and a little bit false. So the closer to truth something seems, the more dangerous that wisdom would be. Is it really from the Lord? And if I'm being honest, in my life and in yours, we might be pursuing wisdom in things that are not from above. Now, you're not going to look in your Bible and find out what time the Denver Nuggets play tonight. Dale, they play tonight. But that's not really where wisdom is, right? That's information. My life shouldn't be guided by the facts of the day, forecast, and what's the traffic like on my way to work. I mean, yeah, you need to reference things of the world for that, but don't aim your life based on what the news tells you. Don't shape your entire existence because of what somebody has found to be a new discovery of the human condition. Or the confusion of gender or all the other things the world wants to throw your direction. Church, God has given us the foundation for life to be built upon and allows us to live in a world where you can choose a flavor of ice cream and all the different things because life is fun and full of experiences. But the world's wisdom does lack what the wisdom from the Lord has. And so point two, we'll do this twice. Again, I'm going to fork the road. So first, wisdom not from above can be revealed. You'll see this in verses 14 to 15. Wisdom is revealed. Wisdom shows its fruit. You're obviously, over time, going to discover, is it from above, from the following things that James gives us. And so in verses 14 and 15, notice what it says. If you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. So the first thing that we see in this, church, is that there is jealousy and selfish ambition in the wisdom of the world, in the not from above wisdom. It is revealing itself by the fruit of focusing on self. Do we find that to be true? I mean, I think it's not an American thing only. You know how much America sets a standard that the world wants to follow in behind? That's my actually concern that happens sometimes in Mexico, is the Americans come and all of a sudden they're going to have all the answers. No! Same spirit that lives in me lives in you. You don't need us. You need the Lord. And by the way, Jesus was not American. All right. Now the reality is, church, is that we need to be honest and understand that there can be a self-centeredness that's a lot of the wisdom of the world. What's best for me? What's best for this? And there's a song, I don't advise you to go out and look it up, but just know that it exists in the world. Clap your hands if you know that happiness is the truth. And people they're singing it, but it's like their life. I mean, if it makes me happy, it must be true. And that's what the world offers as an option, as think of yourself. And you can see this jealousy and this ambition in our hearts. Now, church, again, it's going to come up later. You'll see it in verse 16, right? That's the description later even in that passage. But this is one of the things that the wisdom of the world reveals, is in this jealousy and this selfish ambition. And Paul says, or James says rather, don't boast, don't flaunt that in front of other people. Don't be so proud of that reality, because that is false to the truth. That's not really what wisdom is at all. Remember last week, not many of you should become teachers. Well, if you're a teacher, you have to have something to offer in wisdom. If your wisdom is this, keep your mouth shut. Don't be contrary, false to the truth. Because he says, this is not wisdom that comes from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. And these three phrases are very helpful for us, because the wisdom of the world is of the world. It has no context of things beyond it. It is earthly. It's what feels good, what tastes good, what helps me have more comfort in my life. And so I'm going to pursue things that are going to make my life better here on earth. That's what the wisdom of the world is. That's what it has to be. But it's also unspiritual. It lacks the thought of the spiritual life. In fact, some people, whether agnosticism or atheism, right, they don't even think the spiritual exists. It's just, if it's not part of my five senses, then it can't be even tested. It can't even be proven. It can't even be pursued. And so there are people that deny the spiritual. That's wisdom of the world. And demonic. Now, many of us, if we hear the word demon or think of demonic, there is a reality of destructive. But consider the throne of God for a moment, when all angels were praising him before the fall of the evil one. Right? They're worshiping God. They're created to worship him. And what happens? Selfish ambition of, I want to be praised too, or I want to do things a little differently than what God wanted me to do, caused a portion of the angels to rebel, thus becoming demonic, being sentenced to a life of torture and separation from God. But church, this is a phrase that describes bitter jealousy, selfish ambition. That's what the world's wisdom is. Do we see it? Now, I said this is wisdom revealed, and the reality is, if we're honest, some of us don't want to look at the fruit because it tastes so good. I enjoy doing things that make me feel better. I enjoy going places where I'm more comfortable. I enjoy cushioned chairs, even though I don't sit on one while I preach. Like, there are things in life that we just like, it's good to take care of ourselves, but if we're not careful, we can do that so much that we neglect the things of God. Like, it's really comfortable to go out to eat and to have a good meal, but the waitress that I can tell was crying in the back and bringing out my food now, I don't really want to ask her how her day's going. That's really hard. She'll be okay. God, help her to be okay. I don't really want to talk to her. Help somebody else talk to her and pay my bill and leave. And you give her a big tip and you feel good about yourself. But that's driven by our comfort, isn't it? And that's driven by the worldly wisdom of what do I want, and not thinking of somebody else. It's really self-focused, which is what we see is revealed of all the wisdom of the world. It only thinks of yourself. In fact, I've been dealing with this with my children who have claimed faith and been baptized, and there's often a, hey, are you thinking of yourself right now or thinking of somebody else? So I've been using the term mirror. If I see them kind of thinking selfishly of, get home from school and I'm going to watch the show I want to watch, I'm just like, hey, mirror, because you're just looking at yourself in the mirror. You're just focused on yourself. And I think it's something we struggle against, even as Christians. Die to self how often? Daily. Take up our cross and follow him. So church, be careful when we observe wisdom. Does it reveal itself through selfish motives, through jealousy? Be careful. It's false to the truth. But also from above has results. Wisdom from above has results. And so you see this, that where those things exist, what? There will be disorder and every vile practice. This is what's in the wake of, or in the path after wisdom has come through, of the worldly wisdom. Disorder, vile practice, things that are not honoring to the Lord, things that we wouldn't even imagine are possible, can happen when we think of only ourselves. The danger of the world's philosophy of selfishness is what's good for me is probably not good for you. If you don't believe me, then I'd like to borrow your car and not give it back. It's good for me. I don't want to have car payments. You can keep paying the insurance, actually. That'd be great. So please do that. I'll borrow your keys. I'd be happy to give it to you when I'm done with it. That'd be great for me. Not so good for you. And when you have a selfish community, selfish home, selfish church, selfish country, it's always attack, attack, defend, defend, because you never feel like anybody's helping you. Everybody's out for themselves. A movie that I don't recommend that you go and see, but has a beautiful clip of this separation, is The Bucket List. And there's a beautiful scene I want to show you here of this discussion between one who is aware of and aware, pursuing the Lord. I can't guarantee the faith of this person, but at least open to the idea of God. And the other one that's like, there is no God. So watch this video.
It's indescribably beautiful. Love flying over the polar cap. Above the desolation. The stars. Really one of God's good ones. So you think a being of some sort did all this?
You don't?
You mean, do I believe if I look up in the sky and promise this or that, the biggie will make all this go away? No.
And 95% of the people on Earth are wrong.
Life has taught me anything, it's that 95% of the people are always wrong.
It's called faith.
I honestly envy people who have faith. I just can't get my head around it.
Maybe your head's in the way.
Carter, we've all had hundreds of these discussions, and every one of them always hits the same wall. Is there a sugar plum fairy or not? And nobody has ever gotten over that wall.
So, what do you believe?
I resist all beliefs.
No Big Bang, random universe.
We live, we die, and the wheels on the bus go round and round.
What if you're wrong?
I'd love to be wrong. If I'm wrong, I win.
Not sure it works that way.
Well, you're not claiming you know something I don't. Mm-mm.
I just have faith.
He just has faith. And there are people in our world today that don't have faith, that don't know what faith is. You can go to the wisdom from above. Thank you. So it'll be a little bit shorter in terms of time, but I want to make sure you're aware of what this wisdom looks like. It is revealed as well as the world one was, but it's revealed in different ways. And it is also having a result, because when we have wisdom, again, it is in our actions, experienced by the people, not just something you keep to yourself. So church, there is this difference of faith. We've been talking about it in this whole book. So wisdom is revealed from above. Notice it is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And if you look paralleling this to the previous, remember jealousy, selfish ambition. Church, this is something that we understand that it was contrary to the truth. No, the wisdom of God is pure. It creates peace. It is gentle. It's willing to talk to people. It's not all about yourself. Mercy and fruits, impartial, sincere. Church, it is an us community. It is compassionate. But it also has results. Look at verse 18. Because wisdom from above, resulting in this idea of peaceable, notice, A harvest of righteousness, of honoring the Lord, doing what he wants us to do, is sown in peace by those who make peace. Now, I'm not here to say that we should never stand up for what God says. Peace is not quiet. But peace is pursuing, if at all possible, be at peace among all men, that I want to pray for you and I want to tell you the truth in love, grace and truth. And so I want to ask this question in closing of how can our lives demonstrate more wisdom from above? And I'm willing to hear some answers in your thoughts, but being not just hearers of the word, but being doers of the word, how can we have a wisdom that is peaceable, that is pure, that is gentle, that has mercy? How can these things actually look like in our life? Because it's one thing to say, I live a life that's merciful. But what does it look like tomorrow? What does it look like at lunch today? What does it look like when your son calls you and you don't want to talk to him because of all the things he's done? How does it look then? So if you'd be willing to share some specific examples of how can our lives demonstrate this kind of wisdom? Because the world is hungry and it is starving. And it is our responsibility to show the world what true wisdom from above can look like. It's not just the role of me as a pastor and send them some video of my sermon. No, the same spirit that dwells in me dwells in all of us. And so God wants us to show this kind of wisdom in our day-to-day life. So turning the pulpit around, what does this wisdom look like in demonstration of our lives? Shouldn't be new. I ask you to talk every Sunday. Joe, God bless you. So the Bible, you referenced, it's not IQs, not SAT scores. The Bible tells you what kind of woman to marry. The wisdom from the scriptures, or from the Holy Spirit, tells you who to marry. So it gives you detail. It gives you specific day-to-day walking directions. Help, right? He's called our comforter, our guide. Doesn't just give you a category. It's good. What else? Yes. I would say kindness. Can you give an example of where you were or kind or someone was kind to you? What did that look like?
That last example of kindness after my wife passed. People from the church and outside the church, friends, neighbors.
Yes. So after Wilma's passing, people showed their kindness. I'm going to fill in the blank probably, but by bringing food, by sitting and talking with you, just their companionship, these acts of kindness, these showing that they care. And I'm glad the Lord has allowed you to have people around you in this time of difficulty. Anybody else? What does this kind of wisdom look like? How can we demonstrate it? Let our not just be hearers of the word, but doers of the word, remember? Show grace in difficult moments when you could choose other options, maybe even justified other options. But they don't deserve it, you're right. And we don't deserve the cross. So I'm going to show grace, because grace is never deserved, is that correct? Grace is always an undeserved action of love. What else? Mercy. Yeah. I won't push you on it, but mercy is often held as, and it's loosely defined because there's so much more layers to it, but holding back what somebody does deserve, right? So that person does not deserve for me to text them back or sit with them at lunch or whatever that looked like. They wronged me. And you can show mercy by giving them another chance, by taking the phone call, by sitting by them again. Anybody else? Yep, so when you observe a need in somebody's life, not delaying, but responding as the Lord moves in you, even now, or soon, to whatever extent that would be, that allowing for God to direct our our time of response, because it's often inconvenient, isn't it? It's often in the middle of the night or when you're on your way to something. But God can allow you to have in that moment a yes, Lord mentality. Like Jairus' daughter, remember the woman who touched his cloak? Jesus didn't say, hold on, I got to go here first. He paused and he was loved on the woman because that's the opportunity that he had. Yeah. One more. Anybody think? It's important that we think about this. This is not just, we need wisdom from above. Yeah. How? What does it look like? Because this is actually possible for all of us. That's right. Yeah, expression of faith whenever possible, when we meet various people in different seasons or struggles. I can't allow this WWJD bracelet to be the only thing that tells people I'm a Christian. If I took this off, if I'll do it now, if I can, I think. I want them to still know I'm a Christian. It's not the cross you wear on your neck. It's not you pulled into a church on a Sunday morning. It's not, oh, you have a Bible on your kitchen table. It's how we respond during the traffic jam. It's how we respond to that boss who gives you another assignment on a Friday when you're about to go home. It's how you respond to your spouse who's not listening to you or doesn't give you enough time or enough help around the home or whatever the situation may be. Church, God can allow us to have wisdom from above that people can taste and see. Not for our glory, but for His. Remember, He's the source of it, which moves. Yeah, offering forgiveness in our hurts, honoring God in all that we do or our praise. Thank you online for commenting. Thank you, Ed, for bringing that to my attention. Again, it's important, church, that we understand that these are things that we need people to see, but we also need to be careful not to take the credit. It's not wisdom from you that God gave you. It's wisdom from above. Remember, what is the source? And so I'm going to close again with this first verse. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. It's not about do you have wisdom. It's how are we using it? Let me just close by saying, church, we need God's help. Because it's so easy to get on autopilot and run in a hamster wheel and just go through the days. I mean, tomorrow's Monday and the next day's Tuesday, and we got our schedules and our calendars, and it can just be filled up. But God can help us to use the wisdom that He's given us through His Word and His Holy Spirit to demonstrate our faith in action. And that's my prayer for you even this morning. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for your love. Thank you for your care in our lives. And I ask that you would help us to see the world through your eyes. I pray that your Holy Spirit would intensify our radar, our ability to see things as they really are. And God, this morning, if any of us realize that the wisdom that we've been living in response to is not from above, I pray that we would graciously leave it. It could be friends, it could be experiences or job situations. Lord, I pray that we would graciously say, I can't do this anymore. But in the same way, Lord, stir in us to see what is wisdom from above and creating us a greater hunger, a greater thirst, that we say, I had some, but I need more. You said, apart from you, we can do nothing. And as a deer pants for water, so our souls long for you. So God, I pray that this morning, for all of us, you would make us thirsty. And that you would satisfy with living water so that we would never thirst again. But God, we say, we can't live without you. If you're not going to go with us, we don't want to go. Where else would we go? You have the words of truth. May this be the cry of our heart. Thank you for being a God who has given us your word and your spirit and the promises that we will see you face to face. We long for the day. But while we wait, help us to be faithful. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.